हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू बॉट ठाकुर आईएएस एकेडमी, नॉर्थ ईस्ट प्रीमियर इंस्टीट्यूट फॉर यूपीएससी, एपीएससी एंड एनपीएससी प्रिपरेशंस। आई एम योर फ्रेंड अट्रेई एंड टुडे आई एम हियर विथ अनदर सेगमेंट ऑफ करंट अफेयर्स 365, डेटेड 9th of November 2021। करंट अफेयर्स 365 इज योर वन स्टॉप सोल्यूशन फॉर एनी न्यूज एंड अपडेट्स विच विल हेल्प यू प्रिपेयर फॉर योर सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन, एंड अलॉन्ग विद दैट इट इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू बी बेनिफिशियल फॉर एनी अदर Assam State Government Services. So don't forget to like and share this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can also follow us on Facebook as well as Instagram for any further details related to job notifications. The first news for today is about the 2020 Padma Awards. Recently, the President of India presented the Padma Awards to 119 recipients for the year 2020 at the Rashtrapati Bhavan. This year's list comprises of 7 Padma Vibhushans, 10 Padma Bhushans and 102 Padma Shri Awards. The Padma Awards are announced annually on 26th of January, that is on Republic Day, and it was instituted in 1954. It is one of the highest civilian honours of India. A higher category of Padma Award can be conferred on a person only when there is a gap of at least 5 years since conferment of the earlier Padma Award. The main objective behind conferring these awards is to seek, that is, this these awards, they seek to recognize achievements in all fields of activities or disciplines where an element of public service is involved. These awards are categorized into three different groups. First is the Padma Vibhushan, which is for exceptional and distinguished service. Second one is Padma Bhushan, for distinguished service of higher order. And Padma Shri, which is for, again, distinguished services. Padma Vibhushan is highest in the hierarchy of Padma Awards, followed by Padma Bhushan and the Padma Shri. The awards are given in various disciplines or fields like art, social work, public affairs, science and engineering, trade and industry, sports, civil services, literature, medicine, etc. There is a selection process which is involved. First is the Padma Awards Committee. The awards are conferred on recommendations made by the Padma Award Committee, which is constituted by the Prime Minister every year. And the awards are presented by the President of India, usually in the month of March, April every year. Then along with that, I would also like to mention about the Bharat Ratna Award, which is the highest civilian award of our country. And it is awarded in recognition of exceptional service of the highest order in any field of human endeavor. This is also treated on a different footing from the Padma Award. The recommendations for Bharat Ratna, these are made by the Prime Minister to the President of India, and no formal recommendations are necessary for Bharat Ratna. The number of Bharat Ratna awards is restricted to a maximum of 3 in a particular year. And government has conferred Bharat Ratna Award on 45 persons till date. Now, let us take a look at the Padma awardees from Assam. We have Imran Shah, who is an eminent writer, poet, novelist and scholar. He has been awarded Padma Shri in the field of literature and education. Raman Sharma, who is a distinguished writer, columnist and a member of Guwahati High Court Bar Association. He has been awarded the Padma Shri in the field of literature and education. We have Birubala Rabha. She is a social activist and has been awarded Padma Shri in the field of social work. Then we have Dulal Manki, who is a singer from Assam, and he is also popularly known as the Chumur Samrat. He is awarded Padma Shri for promoting the art and culture of the tribe community. We also have Mangal Singh Hazwari, who is a Boro poet and a recipient of Sahitya Academy Award. And he has been awarded Padma Shri in the field of literature and education. Then we have Bijoya Chakravarti, Gopiram Borgayon Burabhakot, who is a veteran Assamese folk musician from the district of Majuli. And he has contributed towards the field of Satriya music he has been contributing for over 7 decades. Then we have Lakhimi Borua. She started the Konaklota Mahila Urban Cooperative Bank in 1998 in Jorhat in order to help women so that they can be financially independent and secure. And lastly, we have Torun Gogoi, who was Assam's chief minister for 3 consecutive years of 2001, from 2001 to 2016. So these are the Padma awardees from the state of Assam. The second news is all about increasing export of technical textiles. Technical textiles are functional fabrics which have applications across various industries like civil engineering and construction, agriculture, automobiles, healthcare, industrial safety, personal protection, etc. These products, they derive their demand from the development and industrialization of a particular country. Based on the usage, there are 12 technical textile segments. Some of them includes agrotech, meditech, mobile tech, cloth tech, then geotech, etc. Mobile tech, it refers to the products which are in a vehicle, which are related to seat belts, airbags, airplane seats, etc. And geotech is also one of the fastest growing subsegment, which is used to hold back soil. Now, coming to the difference, basic difference between conventional textiles and technical textiles. Conventional textiles are manufactured for aesthetics or for decorative purpose mainly. Here, the fiber can be natural or synthetic, and it is usually first spun into yarns, and then these are woven into or knitted into the fabric. Now, next, coming to technical textiles, these are mainly manufactured for performance or function related purpose rather than aesthetics. And these can be both woven or non-woven and is made out of primarily synthetic materials and in some cases, rare cases, some natural fibers. Coming to the current scenario of technical textiles in our country and abroad, the growth of technical textiles in India has been gaining momentum in the past 5 years, and the current growth is at an 8% per annum rate. The current world market is about 250 billion USD, which is close to 18 lakh crore rupees, and India's share in it is 19 billion US dollars. India is also an aspiring player with 40 billion USD in this market, which is 8% of the share. The biggest players includes USA, Western Europe, China, and Japan. The major challenges which are not allowing us to prosper in this particular field can be like, these can be pointed out as follows. First is the lack of awareness. The benefits of technical textiles are still unknown to a larger section of our population. Second is development of skilled workforce. This industry, technical textiles, they require different and very high levels of skill sets from the workers, which is currently absent in our domestic industry. Along with that, there is lack of research and development, which is one of the key issues that the Indian technical textiles industry is facing. And this is also the main cause of a lack of product diversification in our market. Then next point is related to imports of technical textiles. India imports a significant amount of technical textiles consisting of products from China and US and Europe, which means that Indian technical textile industry is lacking scale and the capacities to manufacture high-tech products. On the other hand, this particular industry holds many opportunities, like a specific one being its gradual growth in the manufacturing sector. Technical textile, they primarily finds usage in various manufacturing industries like automobile, then construction, aviation, etc. So the manufacturing sector has been a pillar of growth for our country's economy, with many such industries registering double-digit growth over the last decade. Along with that, there is a rising importance of healthcare and hygiene. With the ever-growing danger of population and diseases, people are currently shifting towards more hygienic and healthy ways of living, which involves products like face wipes, masks, diapers, dental floss, etc. And all these products, they consume various technical textile items in different forms. Along with that, there is also increasing focus on the field of sports. So, sport equipments, then artificial turfs and composites, sport wears, active wears, all these items, they consume technical textiles. And this growing fitness and sports phenomena, it presents a big opportunity for the technical textiles. So, these are some of the opportunities, possible opportunities in this field. Along with that, if we have a look at the initiatives that are related to technical textiles, then we can name the National Technical Textile Mission. It was launched in February last year with an aim to position our country as a global leader in terms of technical textiles. Also, we have product-linked incentive scheme for the textile sector. This particular PLI, it aims to promote the production of high-value man-made fiber, fabrics, and garments and technical textiles. Along with that, we can also name Technotex India, which is a flagship event that is being organized by the Ministry of Textiles in collaboration with the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry. And it comprises of exhibitions, conferences, seminars with participations of stakeholders from across the global technical textile value chain. So currently, the government, along with industry, they need to build a strong infrastructure which can educate the people about technical textiles. And it can be done by incorporating some basic informations about technical textiles at the school and college level. Along with that, they can also conduct awareness programs like road shows, seminars. Then they can also do promotions through digital and social media, etc. The young and aspiring entrepreneurs, they must take this opportunity and should learn to invest in research and development of technical textiles, which can give them benefits in the upcoming years. The next news is about the Global Drug Policy Index of 2021. This index has been released by the Harm Reduction Consortium, which is a global consortium of networks that is aiming to challenge the global war on drugs and is trying to scale up access to harm reduction services along with advocating for increased resources for harm reduction. This index is a data-driven global analysis of drug policies and their implementation, which comes at a time when the Indian government is trying to review the provisions of the Narcotics, Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act of 1985. This index is a unique tool that documents, measures, and compares the national level drug policies. It provides each country with a score and ranking that shows how much their drug policies and their implementations align with the United Nations principles of human rights, health, and development. This index evaluates the performance of 30 countries covering all regions of the world, and the index provides an essential accountability and evaluation mechanism in the field of drug policy. Here are five dimensions based on which the scores are provided. It includes health and harm reduction, then availability and access to controlled medicines, development, absence of extreme sentencing and responses, and finally, proportionality of the criminal justice responses. And the major objective of this index includes mapping the range of drug policy responses around the world, identifying key aspects of drug policy needing urgent action, facilitating discussions on reform options, and finally, guiding national level policy making priorities and reforms. Major findings of this index includes global dominance of drug policies, which are based on punishment and repression. This has led to low scores overall. And here, the median score in this index is 48 out of 100, and the top ranking country, which is Norway, it has scored 40, 74 out of 100. The standards and expectations from the civil society experts on drug policy, this varies from country to country. Also, inequality is deeply rooted in global drug policies, with the top five countries scoring three times as much as the lowest ranking five countries. So the drug policies, they disproportionately affect people who are marginalized on the basis of their gender, ethnicity, sexual orientation, as well as socioeconomic status. There are also wide disparities between the state policies and how they are being implemented on the grassroots level. Coming to India's performance here in this particular index, India has ranked 18 out of the 30 countries with an overall score of 46 out of 100. The next news is related to mass extinction, which will be tagged under GS Paper 3 under the subtopics of environmental pollution and degradation. Now, this news has come after a paper that has been published in the international journal named Nature Geoscience. And this is related to certain reasons which are responsible towards the first, which led to the first mass extinction, also known as the Ordovician mass extinction. Mass extinction is actually an event when the species, they vanish from the surface of the earth at a rate which is much faster than these are replaced. And it is about 75% of the world species which is being lost within a short amount of geological time, that is less than 2.8 million years. As per this paper, or as per the scientific study, It says that the cooling climate likely changed ocean circulation pattern, and that caused a disruption in the flow of oxygen-rich water, which ultimately led to the mass extinction of many marine creatures. If we have a look at the mass extinctions so far, then the first mass extinction, it occurred about 445 million years ago, which is the Ordovician mass extinction, and that killed around 85% of all the species. Next, the second one is the Devonian mass extinction, which wiped out 75% of world species, followed by the third one, which is known as Permian mass extinction, or also known as the Great Dying. It caused the extinction of over 95% of all the species. Next two extinctions were named as Triassic mass extinction, which included elimination of some dinosaurs. And the fifth one, that is the Cretaceous mass extinction, it is known for wiping out non-avian dinosaurs. So, as per traditional thought, they used to believe that the volcanism-induced global warming, it causes oceans to lose their oxygen content, and thus it impacts the marine population, which destabilizes the entire ecosystem. But in recent times, there are many evidences which points towards several episodes in Earth's history where oxygen levels also dropped due to cooling climates. Thus, this paper, scientific paper which was published, it concludes that climate cooling may also have led to changes in the nutrient cycling in primary producer communities, which ultimately drove the Ordovician mass extinction. Currently, there is also the sixth mass extinction, which is the ongoing mass extinction. The researchers, they have pointed out that this current one is because of the results of human-induced climate changes. It will be referred to as the Anthropocene extinction. And only an estimated 2% of all the species that have lived on Earth's surface are alive. But now the absolute number of species is greater than ever before. So it is described as one of the most serious environmental problems because the loss of species are going to be permanent. This extinction of species, it causes impact such as in the form of loss of crop pollination and water purification. And also further, if a species has a specific function in the ecosystem, then the loss of that particular species, it can lead to consequences for other species by impacting the food chain. So, the effect of extinction are expected to worsen the genetic and cultural variability, which can change the entire ecosystem. When genetic variability and resilience is reduced, its contribution to human welfare can also be lost at the same time.
And this was all for today. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope it will be helpful. Don't forget to like and share this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel. I'll see you all again tomorrow with another segment of Current Affairs 365 only on Borthakur's IAS Academy, Northeast's premier institute for UPSC, APSC and NPSC preparations. Till then, take good care of yourselves and keep learning. Bye-bye.
Borthakur IAS Academy. Prastuti aru adhyayanor nirbhorjoggyo thikona. Borthakur IAS.